Daily Minutes nummer 1459 met een uitzending voor vandaag 3 november 2018. Dit is het bulletin van zaterdag. De uitzending is vandaag voor een deel in het Engels, maar we beginnen met een flink stuk in het Nederlands. Want ik heb de voor gisteren bestemde aflevering van, tenminste deel 2 van de serie over vossenjagen, toch maar vandaag ingesproken. Althans, dat ga ik zo doen. Ik heb hem net geschreven. Het blijkt mogelijk te zijn trouwens om Slow Scan Radio tegelijkertijd op twee frequenties uit te zenden. De tweede frequentie is dan 7440 kHz. Dat gaat waarschijnlijk over iets grotere afstand, ook met 10 kW zendvermogen. Mogelijk dat dat al vanaf aanstaande woensdag gaat gebeuren. Overigens is de storende zender gisteren overstag gegaan en naar een andere frequentie uitgeweken, zodat de uitzending waarschijnlijk aanstaande woensdag ofwel in UTC ofwel in wintertijd op het oude tijdstip kan worden uitgezonden. Ik probeer nu in elk geval dezelfde verwarring als van de week over het uitzendtijdstip te voorkomen. Er waren wat suggesties van mensen die veel van propagatie weten om de uitzending naar de middag te verplaatsen, maar ik heb zelf nog even gekeken. Dat lijkt vooralsnog geen goed idee, dus ik denk wel dat we op het oude tijdstip weer terechtkomen. Dit is dus deel 2 van de serie over vossenjagen. In deel 1 vertelde ik over de cultuur van het vossenjagen in regio 15, het Gooi, waardoor ik zelf geïnspireerd raakte om in mijn woonplaats ook vossenjachten te gaan organiseren. Het speelde allemaal eind jaren 70, begin jaren 80. Ik vertelde in deel 1, moet ik zeggen, over de zogenaamde piepers. Kleine zendertjes die bij een nietsvermoedende amateur nabij het huis verstopt werden. Ook de Hilversumse vossenjachten zelf stonden bekend om dit soort creatieve hoogstandjes. Het kostte mij niet veel tijd om deze forse streken over te nemen. Misschien dat ik later in de serie daar nog wel een keer opnieuw op inga. Ik beperk me nu tot wat hoogtepunten. Nou ja, dat waren ze niet voor de deelnemers dan. Overigens is daar ook wel eens een wraak voor genomen op ondergetekende. En ik kon alleen maar zeggen, ja, dat roep je over je af. In het jaar dat er een zeer strenge winter was, ik denk dat het 1979 was, hadden we een vossenjacht die net in de week gehouden werd dat de vorst weer uit de grond was. De jagers reden bij die jachten meestal met twee man, of soms een man en een vrouw, of twee vrouwen in een auto. De start van die jachten was traditioneel bij het Belgenmonument in Amersfoort, vlakbij de huidige repeater PI3 AMF, tevens het hoogste punt van de regio. Dat was zo gekozen omdat je dan goed in het rond zou kunnen peilen. De vos met onder andere ondergetekende zat in een oud gemaal van de rivier de Eem, nabij Eemnes. Het gemaal zat naast een soort meertje bij een uitloper van de Eem. Hoewel het gemaal volledig functioneel was, was het gebouw niet in de beste staat van onderhoud. Het was ook al een oud gebouw uit 1900 of zo. Zo was bijvoorbeeld de stalen deur van het voormalige stookhok niet meer afsluitbaar. Dat was dus een mooie ruimte om als het weer wat slechter was als vos binnen te kunnen schuilen. En we hadden daar ook de apparatuur en de accu's neergezet. Volgens mij waren we wel met 3 man bij de zender aanwezig. Het weer was uitstekend eigenlijk, hoewel het frisjes was. En het zicht was goed. Ik weet niet meer zeker in hoeverre we dit allemaal van tevoren gezien of bedacht hadden. Maar als je vanaf het Belgenmonument op dit punt aankwam, dan zat je precies op een plek waarbij je aan beide kanten tamelijk ver verwijderd was van een brug. 2,5 kilometer in de ene richting, maar via slingerweggetjes en een kilometer of 3 in de andere richting, waarbij je dus ook een flinke omweg moest maken. Wij zaten met de vos aan de overkant van het water, maar door het sterke signaal dachten de pijlers dat we aan hun kant zaten. Naar de rivier toe was er vanwege de vorst die net uit de grond was dus alleen maar blubber en meerdere auto's kwamen daar vervolgens in vast te zitten. Er werden vervolgens schijnwerpers opgezet die enkele op hun voertuig hadden, zodat we alles met onze verrekijkers prima konden zien. En net zo goed als het signaal van de vos naar de overkant ging, zo kwamen de gesprekken en het gevloek en het getier vanaf de andere kant ook bij ons terecht. Een vriend van mij, die helaas niet meer onder ons is, probeerde de deusje Vodiana waarmee hij gekomen was met 2 handen aan de achterkant uit de blubber te tillen, terwijl zijn medejager het stuur en het gaspedaal bediende. Hij zat op een gegeven moment op zijn achterste in de modder. In het zaaltje met de prijsuitreiking zat zeker de helft van de jagers grotendeels onder de blubber. Kortom, het was een uiterst gezellige avond.
This is ARRL Audio News, your weekly summary of news highlights from the world of amateur radio. If you retransmit audio news through a repeater, listen for the Morse code K character, followed by 4 seconds of silence. That's your cue to stop transmitting so that your repeater timer can reset.
I'm Carla Pereira, KC1HSX, and these are our stories for Friday, November 2nd. Hamvention will host the 2019 ARRL National Convention May 17 through 19 in Xenia, Ohio. Hamvention, the largest annual amateur radio gathering in the U.S., and the ARRL National Convention will share the joint theme of mentoring the next generation of amateur radio operators. As host of the 2019 ARRL National Convention, Hamvention will feature dozens of forums covering a variety of amateur radio topics in the areas of technology, public service, on-air operating, training, and learning. A track of presentations will be organized to build on the mentorship theme, encouraging more individuals and radio clubs to lead new and inexperienced radio amateurs to become more active, involved, and engaged. Special event station W8BI will operate from the fairgrounds, and conventioneers will have an opportunity to get on the air from Hamvention. The National Convention will feature ARRL Expo, a large assembly of exhibits, activities, and representatives for ARRL programs and services. Details will be posted as they become available. Hamvention 2019 will be the third held at the Greene County Fairgrounds and Expo Center in Xenia since the event relocated from Dayton. In 2018, Hamvention recorded its third largest attendance ever with 28,417 attendees. Hamvention is a traditional meeting space for radio amateurs from all over, and the event attracts many international attendees each spring. ARRL is opposing a petition for rulemaking, RM11815, by several vehicle manufacturers that calls on the FCC to adopt field strength limits in Section 18.305 that would allow higher power wireless charging technologies operating in the 79 to 90 kHz range to accommodate what the petitioners call next generation wireless power transfer for electric vehicles, also called WPTEV. In comments filed on October 29th, ARRL contends that the petition is woefully incomplete and inadequate in its analysis of consequent out-of-band emissions from WPTEV systems in the low and medium frequency ranges using upward of 11 kilowatts of power. Given the high power levels, ARRL said harmonic emissions from WPTEV systems could be appreciable, with the AM broadcast band and amateur radio as potential interference victims. The issue of WPTEV is a World Radio Communication Conference 2019 agenda item, for which studies are still underway. The petition was premature, ARRL said, because, quote, it quite obviously prejudges the outcome of WRC 19 agenda item 9.1.6, unquote. The petition seeks a specific field strength limit of 74.4 dB microamps per meter at a distance of 10 meters, regardless of the charging system's operating environment. That works out to about 2.07 volts per meter. The petition presumes that the optimum internationally harmonized frequency range for WPTEV is already known to be 79 to 90 kHz, and that the optimum field strength to minimize any impact on radio communication services has been established. ARRL called on the Commission to deny the petition without prejudice or dismiss it altogether. Filing the petition jointly were BMW of North America, Ford Motor Company, Nissan of North America, and Toyota of North America, who maintain that higher power wireless charging will help reduce barriers to consumer acceptance of electric vehicles. The Bank of Lithuania has released a commemorative 5-euro gold coin featuring the country's LithuaniaSat-1 and LitSat-1 amateur radio satellites. The two CubeSats were launched to the International Space Station on January 9, 2014, and deployed from the ISS on February 28. LithuaniaSat-1 carried a FM transponder and camera, while LitSat-1 had a linear SSB CW transponder. The face of the gold coin features the Lithuanian coat of arms as a star constellation, with LithuaniaSat-1 and LitSat-1 on the other side. The new ARRL contest landing page at contests.arrl.org continues to develop with the addition of enhanced and expanded contest reporting. The contest page will soon include complete 2018 results, including full results articles from QST, expanded results, line scores, log checking reports, soapbox, and database research. Contests are listed and linked in the left-hand column of the page and as tabs at the top of the page for categories of log submissions, logs received, certificates, and clubs. When users select an event from the left-hand column, the page will display activity links that include rules, logs received, results articles, and other contests. Selecting results articles takes the user to the full results articles list hyperlinked by year. JK Antenna's Ken Garge, W3JK, has donated a second model JK402T antenna to Maxim Memorial Station W1AW. The antenna is a two-element Yagi on a 22-foot boom with capacitive loading. The JK402T replaces the old Cushcraft XM240 40-meter Yagi that had been used for visitor operations. The donation included a new Balun, donated via W3JK by Balun Designs, LLC. The new antenna went up on the tower on October 30th. Located at approximately 130 feet above ground, the new JK402T exhibits a nearly flat SWR across the entire 40-meter band. W1AW guest operators who may be active on 40 meters with this antenna should see improved performance over the old one, which was showing signs of aging. ARRL President Rick Roderick, K5UR, chaired the ARRL Executive Committee meeting on October 20th in Bloomington, Minnesota. During his opening comments, President Roderick said his membership contacts have indicated that strong support exists for the entry-level license enhancement petition to the FCC, as well as for the volunteer monitor program that would supplant the current official observers. General Counsel Chris Imlay, W3KD, told the committee that the Amateur Radio Parity Act remains alive in Congress as part of the House-passed version of the Financial Services and General Government Authorization Act. The measure now is before a House and Senate conference committee to resolve differences between the versions passed by each House. Imlay indicated that administrative implementation of the bill's provisions remains on the table should the act not be included in the authorization bill. Imlay said the ARRL is awaiting final approval from the FCC for a new Memorandum of Understanding for the Amateur Auxiliary. Discussions are underway with key players planning the rollout and implementation of the Volunteer Monitor Program.
And now with this week's satellite update, here's Bruce Page, KK5DO.
Things just keep getting better for hams. The Philippines launched a new satellite on October 29th. It is Diwata 2 and carries a ham radio experiment. The FM transponder has an uplink of 437.700 MHz and a downlink of 145.900 MHz. It is in a sun-synchronous orbit at an altitude of 613 kilometers. On October 24th at 1320 UTC on SO50, Scott, N1AIA, and Jerome, F4DXV, completed a 5,523 kilometer QSO between Berwick, Maine, and Leyland, France. This eclipses the previous record of 5,410 kilometers set in January of 2017 by MI6GTY and UB9UTJ. Thanks to Paul, N8HM, for this update. Whilst this story is airing, the AMSAT Symposium will be in progress. There should be some new and interesting items to report next week. This is Bruce Page, KK5DO, for the ARRL Audio News.
I'm Steve Ford, WB8IMY, and this is the ARRL Audio News Propagation Forecast for Friday, November 2nd. With the CW sweepstakes starting tomorrow afternoon, there's considerable interest in propagation conditions for this weekend. Unfortunately, the forecast includes a 50-50 chance of geomagnetic disturbances that will likely disrupt the bands above 40 meters if they occur. That's a big if. So, with a spotless sun and the solar flux down to 67, the best bands for this big contest will be 80, 40, and 20 meters. On VHF and UHF, tropo openings on 2 meters and up have been reported between Florida and Louisiana and as far north as Ohio. The entire West Coast has seen activity as well, primarily on 2 meters.
And that concludes ARRL Audio News for this week. Our thanks to all contributors to this week's report. ARRL Audio News is produced by the American Radio Relay League, the National Association for Amateur Radio. For more information on amateur radio or the ARRL, visit us on the web at arrl.org. You can also find us on Facebook and Twitter by searching for ARRL. If you have a question or comment about ARRL Audio News, email us at audionews@arrl.org. This program is copyright ARRL, all rights reserved. 73, and thanks for listening.
I'm Ono of the Foundations of Amateur Radio podcast in Australia, and you're listening to the Daily Minutes by Papa Alpha Zero Echo Tango Echo. Foundations of Amateur Radio. There are people who ask questions, and there are people who answer them. Sometimes the people who answer even know what they're talking about, but sometimes they just repeat what they've been told without any form of critical thought. The reason I raise these is because when you're a new amateur with a shiny new license, you're like a little puppy dog going from tree to tree to have a sniff. Does this smell good? What about this? Oh, that's a nice smell. I wonder what it tastes like. Puppy dog analogies aside, as a new amateur, you're filled with questions and uncertainty. You don't know what you don't know. You don't know how much you don't know. Your license is still wet, so even if you know something, it might not be true. Interestingly, the more I look at this, the more I find that new amateurs, filled with questions, are more likely to dig around in the fundamental understanding of things and learn something along the way. I've been around this community for a little while now. I obtained my license in 2010. I've learnt a lot of different things about this hobby, how it works, what the mechanisms, phenomenon, etiquette, physics, and so on make amateur radio work. Most of the time, I'm learning about some or other new thing. Right now, I'm learning about what a vector network analyzer is and how it works, so I can explain it to someone else. Foundations of Amateur Radio is about how stuff works, much like Joe Kaufman's book, What Makes It Go, though I read it in Dutch when I was growing up, Hoe Zit Dat in Elkaar. There's another series of books by David Macaulay that are my inspiration, The Way Things Work, Unbuilding, Underground, and Motel of the Mysteries, to name a few. It seems that my drive to ask questions is fundamental to my existence. My uncertainty doesn't scare me off. In fact, the opposite is true. It gets me asking more questions, learning more things, gaining a deeper understanding, and finding out more than I ever dreamt was possible. If you're a new amateur, I'd recommend that you attempt to keep your curiosity alive. When you're faced with a fact, question it. Attempt to discover what is underlying the response. There are amateurs who think that to ask the question, why is the length of a dipole calculated using some random constant, is the equivalent of heresy, lack of skill, incompetence, and the source of much derision. When it's clear that even a cursory search reveals that not only is the notion incomplete, it's wrong for most, if not all, examples. My perspective is a little different, and I admit that for some it might be confronting. Why is it so? What makes it go? How come? And why? Are all questions to live by. You might conclude that a world where there are no certain answers is a scary place. But for my money, the opposite is true. Just because you think it's simple and answerable doesn't make it so. If you walk in with your eyes open asking questions, then you'll be much more prepared for an unexpected response. If you've just obtained your license and you're not sure about something, ask. You might not like or understand the answers, but that is just a recipe for more questions. Don't be deterred by those who provide certainty. The more certain they are of their answer, the more you should ask. Amateur radio is about experimentation. It's a license to play, a license to explore. It's a license to investigate. For me, amateur radio is encapsulated in a quote attributed to Albert Einstein. The more I learn, the more I realize how much I don't know. I'm Ono, Victor Kilo 6, Foxtrot Lima Alpha Bravo.
Daily Minutes zijn dagelijks vanaf ongeveer 1900 uur te beluisteren. De uitzending wordt een dag later om 10:30 's ochtends herhaald. Alle mail is welkom op het adres x@xdv.me. Dat is ook te vinden rechts bovenaan de webpagina van de uitzendingen www.pa0ete.nl. De Daily Minutes toont iedere dag weer aan de hand van schokkende voorbeelden hoe een hobby mensenlevens kan veranderen. De internetfaciliteiten en studiohardware voor Daily Minutes worden gesponsord door 70MHzShop.nl. 70MHzShop.nl.
En microfoon naar retour.